Hi viewers, this is Dr. Lakshmi from Vishnu Educational Development and Innovation Center, Vedic, Hyderabad. This presentation I'm doing in our studio, Vedic Studio, thanks to this platform. Today in this presentation, I'm addressing about what is cognitive load theory, how we can use cognitive load theory in the instructional design, how effectively we can use cognitive load theory in the instructional delivery. With the help of cognitive load theory, how we can improve the learning efficacy of the learners and how we can use this cognitive load theory during the content preparation like PowerPoint preparation, PPT. These are on the topic of discussion in this presentation. Let us start with what is cognition. Cognition is the word coined by cognitive psychologists. Cognition related to the power of thinking and the power of emotion or emotional connect, emotional feeling. Thinking and emotion related with the brain and related with the human actions are said to be cognition. Let us start with how brain learns. Brain starts receiving information from the environment and starts assimilating or absorbing the information through five different sensors: eyes, nose, mouth, ears, and kinesthetic touch, by doing things by their hands, by pedaling something by their legs, something kinesthetic. So any information which they receive from the sensory signals or sensory inputs, it starts loading in the sensory memory. All the information input comes to the sensory organs, starts accumulating in the sensory memory. Cognitive psychologists, they term otherwise it's a working memory. The cognitive load theory is highly related to working memory. Teachers can do wonders only with the working memory. We have the influence to work on the working memory of the learner. And once the working memory information or content becomes overloaded, the content will start transferred to the short-term memory biologically. No one can intervene in the content transfer from the sensory memory to the short-term memory. It's biological process. During their sleep, the content, what and all available in the short-term memory will be transferred to the long-term memory. Long-term memory, the information will be available in the form of schemas. Schemas are generated only when the student or anyone start perceiving the information and start thinking and processing and deducing and inducing something upon that information. If they connect strong cues and stimulus with the information, then naturally schemas are created. For the novice user, schemas are very lesser. Long-term users are expert learners. Expert learners, schemas will be very powerful, and periodically the schemas will be start changing or relating and associating, clustering will happen. For the novice user, initially the schema starts building from the scratch. So how we have to take care of this cognitive load for the novice users or novice learner? Cognitive load, what it means, the brain load, the learning load given to the student is meant as cognitive load. And how we can reduce the learning load or brain load of the students or the learners with the support of instructional design and instructional delivery is the topic of discussion in this presentation. Cognitive load theory is universal. What cognitive load means? Effort being used in the working memory, the sensory memory. What is the effort taken by or consumed by, energy consumed by the working memory while learning, especially for the novice users or new learner? It is administered for the efficiency in learning. George Miller in 1956 introduced the terminology cognitive load theory. He announces that short-term memory able to hold 7 plus or minus 2 chunks of information maximum 9 information, minimum 5 information. How this retention rate will be improved to retain this information for the longer duration? It is possible only when strong cues and stimulus are given to the information by the learner internally as well as by the facilitator or the teacher externally. What is chunk of information? Let us discuss now. For example, if you are going to discuss about AC motor, what is AC motor will become one chunk of information. And the circuit diagram for AC motor will become another chunk of information. And working principle of AC motor may be having several chunks of information. And where the AC motors are applicable in the real-time situation, then this becomes another chunk of information. So, short-term memory can able to hold maximum of 9 chunk of information only if the information is provided with more stimulus and cues, both by the learner and both and the external facilitator. Modern origins, Dr. John Sweller conducts a lot of experiments. We may have to thank the digital revolution with the non-invasive tools, brain imaging, brain signal reading. Through that, lot many research going across the world to prove the cognitive load theory, how it affects every individual's performance and how it improves learning efficacy. Again, cognitive load divided into 3 types of load: intrinsic load, extrinsic load, German load. Let us see what is intrinsic load. The inherent level of difficulty associated with a specific instructional topic. For example, if we ask higher education students to do simple arithmetic operation like addition of 2 numbers, subtraction of 2 numbers, multiplication of 2 numbers, division of 2 numbers, there is no much more difficulty involved in it. There is no energy consumption, there is no effort contributed by the learner. It becomes very easy with a lesser effort. This could be done by the adults. Whereas the same higher education students, if we ask them to do differential calculation, integration, then the cognitive load or intrinsic load becomes more. The difficulty associated with the problem also varies from person to person. Inherent level of difficulty associated with the context or with the topic becomes different from one person to different person. Being a teacher, we cannot do anything with intrinsic load, but how we can help? Yes, it is possible. Only with the help of extraneous load, being a teacher, we can help. What is extraneous load? The information is presented to the learner and is under the control of instructional designers. So here we can think of how effectively we can prepare the presentation by applying the aesthetic sense, by applying the font size and text effects, color effects, font size, etc. Providing one information at a time, students could learn better. Always the visual information, visual cue and auditory cue should start synchronizing each other. Right now, I am addressing about extraneous load. Then student should watch the point related with extraneous load when I am delivering a talk about extraneous load. Only then the visual signal and the auditory signal start synchronizing, the better cueing, better stimulus, better learning will happen. So when we provide information, we may have to provide one piece of information at a time rather than providing the complete slide. When we provide the complete slide, a lot of distractions will happen with the students. Again, we may have to take care in this slide, types of cognitive load. Normally, the PowerPoint template will provide larger font size for the title and smaller font size for the text or body of the content. Not necessary to have larger font size in the title. That gives, that attracts, drags the attention of the students. Our interest is to provide this information, these new insights. Types of cognitive load, very simple, no need to drag their attention. Where we want to drag the attention, that portion should be larger in font size, with a different color, with a different stimulus, different cues. Only then we could retain the attention of the students towards the topic of discussion. German load. German load related to the perceiving of the information and how the person starts thinking on the information, how the person starts inducting on the information, how the person starts deducing, concluding and deriving new things and providing solution from the perception of the information, all will constitute one single schema. The final confirmation upon the information received by the learner is said to be schemas. In the long-term memory, all the information absorbed by the learner will be available in the form of schemas. Novice learners, schemas may be weaker, and for the expert learner, schemas will be stronger. Day by day, the schemas will start associating in different factors and start clustering in different methods and start reinforcing more and more signal with their content. Now, only with the extraneous load, center of balance can be provided between the architecture of the learning and the way of facilitating the content. So we may have to take care of extraneous load of the students. How we can simplify the information, how effectively the content could be prepared, how effectively the content could be delivered. Only way a teacher can help the learner to learn in the better way, can give more cues, stimulus, analogies, examples, animations. The way of providing content becomes a matter in the learning, becomes a matter towards attention, becomes a matter towards the attraction also. Now, in this slide, if you provide all the points at a time, then I will be addressing about third question. Students' attraction or attention will be on the first question. Then there is no synchronization happens between the visual signal and the auditory signal. To avoid this, always we should provide only one piece of information at a time, and we may have to deliver the relevant information. Only then synchronization of the visual signal and auditory signal will become matching, and more cues and stronger stimulus will happen internally. Better retention rate will be seen among the learners. So one piece of information at a time we may have to provide. Again, in this slide, if we provide all the information at a time, we may be talking about the last 3 points. Students may be focusing on the first 3 points. Their internal thinking, in internal assimilation, the processing may be upon the top 3 points. We may be discussing about the bottom 3 points. To avoid this, always we have to provide one information at a time. We may have to give cues, explanation, and way of understanding, learn-to-learn activities, then we have to move on to the next topic. This is the way the instructional delivery is to be taken care. Look at this slide. So much information, volume of information is more in this slide. Teacher will be addressing on one portion of the slide. Students will be looking at another portion of the slide. Naturally, brain starts attracted with the colors. With your interested color area, they will be wandering. They will be giving their attention. There is no mismatch. There is no match. There is a mismatch between the auditory signal and the visual signal. In order to avoid this, we may have to provide one piece of information at a time. Now, there is no other distraction in this slide. I'm addressing about what is Google Classroom. I may be talking about what is content management system. I may be talking about what is learning management system. There is no distraction. There is no dilution. Always student will focus on this particular item of information. Once this information becomes familiar to the brain, we move on to the next information, then the focus, attention will be retained among the students. This is the way we may have to provide pieces of information, chunk the information and provide one after another and retain all the information for holistic picture. Providing the holistic picture and discussing the relative association, how we can relate one tool with the other tool, something like that. Only then the retention rate, learning rate will become better. Look at this slide. So many components. I may be talking about technology design. Student may be looking at learning outcome. There is no match with the auditory signal and the visual signal. The moment students start looking at learning outcome, their brain, they will start thinking about something related to learning outcome. I may be talking, being a teacher, I may be facilitating about technology design. There is no synchronization with the signal. Warrant of attention is missing in this slide. So what we have to do? We have to redesign the slide. Providing one piece of information at a time. Now I will be talking about what is e-learning infrastructure, what is a design phase. Then everybody's attention will be focused towards this particular element. Once this element is discussed, once we make familiarization with the student's brain, then we have to move with the next piece of information or chunk of information. Then we may have to move on to the next topic of discussion, next point of discussion, next point of discussion, how interrelationship among all the components and all the chunks of information, we have to move on like this. Look at this slide. Again, volume of information is more. We may discuss at some part of the slide. Students may look at our brain starts absorbing the signal from some other part of the slide. To avoid this, we may have to redesign the slide like this. Provide one piece of information at a time. Start talking about that information for a while, a minute or 5 minutes or 40 minutes, whatever the way you want to discuss, you discuss. Then move on to the next point, point by point. Look at this. Again, it's a clumsy of information. We will focus, shift our attention on some portion of the slide. Students will shift their attention on some other portion of the slide. To avoid this, we may have to redesign the slide with one point at a time. Look at this. Again, volume of information is more in this slide. This will bring a lot of distraction, dilutions, and the students may lose the focus of learning. Always, we may have to provide the information one at a time. We have to chunk the several information into pieces of information. What topic we are on demand, we are discussing, we may have to bring it and discuss and move on to the further topics. This is the way instructional delivery should be facilitated with the support of PowerPoint for the learning efficacy. Again, one piece of information at a time. TPAC framework model. What is TPAC? TPAC stands for technological, pedagogical, and content knowledge. We may have to start discussing about TPAC for few minutes. Then we may have to move on with the next points. In the forthcoming video, I'll be discussing exclusively about TPAC framework model. Keep watching and look at again. Choosing the relationship diagram is also a matter. How the informations are related to each other based on the relationship of the information, we may have to choose the diagram. Not only the font size, not only the aesthetic approach, not only the colors, text effect. Diagrammatic representation is also relevant to the cognitive load. What diagram we have to bring in to give more association, to give better cues and stimulus. So we may have to bring the diagram also relevant to the cognitive load theory, providing one piece of information, how these all are interconnected, providing, look at this slide, clumsy of information, too much of information. We may have to address one point at a time. Now let me explain in this slide how we have to apply the cognitive load theory, or how we may have to use a PowerPoint, what effect we may have to apply on the slide and on upon the points and diagrams to bring the content on demand. Look at, select the first point, go to animations, custom animation is option you may have to choose. Look at this ad effect. Click on this ad effect, go to entrance, look for appear. If it is not available, click more effects, definitely it will be available. Click appear. So this is the order. Number one, the moment the slide is displayed, you can watch the appearance. Upon the click, the first point will come. Now, choose the second point. Again, up, go to the add effect, entrance, appear. Now this is the second point. Upon the second click, this point will be provided on demand. Choose the third point, go to the add effect, and the entrance, appear. Now look at the slide. Now the title of the slide is available. You may introduce about the title for a while. Then within the title, what are the topic of discussion? First point, you can narrate, you can discuss, you can ask question, or you can interact with your student upon the first point, or you can facilitate. Once if this point is understood by the student or your delivery is over, move on to the second point. Then on demand, while clicking or pressing the arrow button, each and every point will be provided on demand. Look at the next slide. Provide as much as possible visual images so that students will start concentrating more, giving their attention. We can create interest so that retention rate will be more. With the interest, with a determination, with a self-motivation, only student can learn. How we can create interest? By providing interesting slides, animations, by providing more visuals, by providing aesthetic approach of the slides, by providing more cues with the bold, providing more cues with the colors, providing more cues with the text effects. So provide images or visuals as much as possible, like this in this slide, and discuss your topics. To break the monotone, you can start with text. Later on, you can bring the images. Here, you are bringing the image first, then you are providing the information. In this slide, more cues are given with the colors. In this slide, more visuals are added. So this is the way we can take care of cognitive load theory. Keep watching. Thanks for watching. In the forthcoming videos, I will be discussing about how we can present with the different online softwares apart from the PowerPoint presentation. And in the forthcoming slide, I'll be discussing about TPAC framework model also. How the TPAC framework model will be useful for the instructional design and how it is useful for the educational research paper writing. Keep watching. Thanks for watching. Thank you all. And in the forthcoming video, I'll be discussing about types of assessment also. Thank you for watching. See you all.